Amen?
Amen.
Now it's time for the spiritual food. Hallelujah. The Amen. Word of God. Amen? Amen? There is power in the word of God. Hallelujah. God is speaking Amen. To us through his word. The Holy Bible is the word of God. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Amen.
As we all gather here today in the presence of the Most High God, now it's time for us to listen to the message of God for today. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm going to call on Reverend Dr. Theo Phillips Lemmel for the word of God.
Amen.
Amen. We thank you, Lord, to count us among the privileged few.
Amen.
To come before your sanctuary this morning.
Amen.
We thank you, Father Almighty, for giving us this opportunity to be fed with your word, so Lord.
Amen.
We sit in the name of Jesus to consecrate your message.
Amen.
And may the tongue that will deliver it, Lord, and open all our hearts to better understand you, Father.
Amen.
May Lord be here as you know, but to us of thy word, Lord.
Yes.
At the end of this message, Father Almighty.
Amen.
Let it be a coming around for our life. And never let our life be the same again.
Amen.
We thank you, Father Almighty.
Thank you, Lord.
For the blood that you shed on the cross of Calvary for our salvation. We thank you for this day in our life.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' name, Father, we pray.
Amen.
Please be seated. The sermon this morning will be coming from the book of Matthew, chapter 17. Matthew, chapter 17. And I'll be reading from verses 14 to 18. Or 14 to 19. Or 14 to 20. Okay. Matthew 17, 14 to 20. Amen.
Yeah.
When they came to the crowd, a man came to Jesus, falling on his knees before him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic and he is very ill, for he often falls into the fire and often into the water. I brought him to your disciples, and they could not cure him. And Jesus answered and said to his disciples, you unbelieving and perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? And how long shall I put up with you? Bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked him, and the demon came out of him, and the boy was cured at once. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why could he not drive it out? And he said to them, because of the littleness of your faith. For truly I say to you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible to you. For this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting.
Amen.
May God bless his holy word.
Amen.
As you could see this morning, you're wondering what are we going to discuss about? Finding your true inner strength. And that is the thing. Finding your true inner strength.
Amen.
Everyone has been born with one form of inner strength. But only few discover theirs before they die.
Yes.
for many occasions. We usually discover our inner strength when we are under tension or dangerous situation we might regard as a matter of life and death. We have read in history historic acts performed by individuals like you and I, either during the war or in captivity or in national disasters or during tragic accidents. These are actions people will never dare have the courage to perform in normal times. Where is your true inner strength? And how do you find your true inner strength? In the scriptures we read about the story of several heroes, like David. He was a man from a common background who did not have the types of opportunities and privileges we have today. But he did not allow his obscure position to suppress his love for God. When all the great armies of Israel were scared stiff to face the Philistine, the Goliath, David from nowhere, with no formal military training, stepped forward to face the trials which the bravest of Israel dared to risk. His strength did not come from the armor and shield that King Saul put on him, but from the inner strength he summoned from God. He relied only on his sling and 5 round stones to overcome the Goliath standing in his path to greatness. If as Christians we are so familiar with the story of David, what lessons have we learned from his life? Where did David's inner strength come from? From his reply, we do know in 1 Samuel 17:45-46, then David said to the Philistines, "You come to me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. This day, the Lord will deliver you up into my hands, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you. And I will give the dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel." Yeah. Amen. Yeah. And the second character was Moses. He was another hero of the Bible. He was a reluctant leader, afraid to take responsibility like most of us today. But even though he doubted his abilities, but God saw a different personality in him, the inner strength hidden in you and I, which unless we are ready to let God use us to accomplish greater things, we will live long and die without achieving anything.
Yes.
This unique leader freed his people from the slavery in Egypt and led them to freedom, setting an example for later generations of Jews. Moses was in fact the founder of a nation, an organizer, lawmaker, and defender of his people. Perhaps the most remarkable quality of this modest man was his love and passion for his people, in spite of their feelings and ingratitude.
Amen.
Moses was the greatest of the prophets, the only person in the Bible who spoke to God face to face, in contrast to other prophets to whom God spoke only in visions and dreams. But he was also something of a tragic figure. He grew up in a foreign court and was rejected at first by his own people when he tried to help them. He became a fugitive when he intervened on behalf of a Hebrew slave and killed an Egyptian. His own people complained when he tried to free them from Pharaoh and slavery. God spoke to Moses from a burning bush. The irony was that Moses had never sought fame. When God called him to be a leader, he did not want the job. He was unsuitable, he thought. Not an inspiring speaker, but a stammerer. But God ordered Moses to take off the burden and healed it through him. God did great wonders which no human in the flesh could do, which means that with God, nothing is impossible.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If God could use Moses, why can he not use you to do great things?
Amen.
And then Esther, our favorite queen, was another woman of great courage. who was a slave in captivity, but God saw something unique in her to entrust the salvation of the whole tribe of Israel in captivity in her hand.
Amen.
You are no better than Esther or any of the great women in history who have liberated their people from slavery, oppression, and poverty. They look up to God and summon their inner strength to action to accomplish a humanly impossible feat.
Amen.
She was humble. She was obedient.
Amen.
She was loyal.
Amen.
She was responsible.
Amen.
She was intelligent.
Amen.
And she was courageous.
Amen.
How many today among our women can boast to possess such simple virtues? Humility, obedience to higher authority, loyalty, display of intelligence, wisdom when demanded, and courage with boldness to face challenges. And these are the qualities we are advocating for you, in you all, and still expecting from most of you, our leaders. Readiness to serve and ability to take responsibility. What statement made Queen Esther to be remembered as a heroine? Let us read Esther chapter 4, verses 15 to 17. Then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, "Go, assemble all the Jews who are found in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maidens also will fast in the same way. And thus I will go in to the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish."
Amen.
So Mordecai went away and did just as Esther has commanded him. Today, out of about so many women we have in the church today, we will find only 5 who will fast every Monday, praying from morning for the blessings of this church and for the members and their families in this church. The question is, where are the other women who are also free on Monday to join this powerful prayer and warrior ministry? We have, for the progress of this church, the responsibility belongs to all of us. If you cannot serve God with your money, will you also deny him your time? There's a wonderful story in the Holy Bible about Samson and Delilah. It seems that no one could find out the secret of Samson's strength. Delilah, with who he fell in love, happened to be a Philistine, free woman. And the general in charge of the Philistine army got to her and asked her to find out the secret of Samson's strength.
Amen.
She tried several different ways. She asked him, "Where does your strength lie?" Samson, who was infatuated with Delilah, gave her different answers. And each time, when they came to capture him, he was able to display his strength. She asked him again, "Where does your strength lie?" But this time when she asked, he finally said his strength was in his hair. So she cut off the locks of his hair one night when he was asleep. And the Philistines came, suppressed him, and captured him, and imprison him. But his hair grew again. And of course his real strength wasn't in his hair alone. But as the story goes on, he found his inner strength again when he cried unto the Lord for help at time of his need. And he also regained his muscular abilities. How many of us really trust God to remember to call on him at times of our need, rather than depending on our own human abilities to solve our problems? Will it be due to our lack of faith? Will it be due to our guilty conscience because we have forsaken him when we were blessed with little comfort? So I ask you, where do your strength lie? What are your strengths? Each of us has strength, and sometimes we are not totally aware of them. Because we focus so much on our weaknesses. We are very ready to focus on our weaknesses and see what we don't have, what we are lacking. But in order to grow spiritually, we really need to focus on our strengths. Ask yourself, where do my strengths lie? We all have our own strengths, and they all come from that same source within us. So it's also a good thing to ask, where does my true strength lie? It lies within you. We need to strengthen that within us. And to do that, we have to turn to the presence. We have to find that stillness in our own being. It says in Isaiah, chapter 30, verse 15, for thus the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, has said, in repentance and rest you will be saved, in quietness and trust in your strength. But you were not willing. Our inner strength cannot be found when we never find time to commune with God. No time to sit down and meditate or think we have any reason for repentance. So we live our lives.